Hello, welcome to Bite Size Med. This video is on some of the anatomy and embryology of the thyroid gland. The thyroid gland is perhaps the most popular of the endocrine glands, and most people know it as this butterfly-shaped organ that sits in the front of the neck. But of course, there's a lot more to it than that. This gland produces very important hormones, the thyroid hormones. This is the first in a four-part series I'm making on the structure and function of the thyroid gland, where we'll explore some of the anatomy and embryology of it, just some essentials, so that we can build from there. In part two, we'll look at the microstructure and what the hormones do. Part three will be on how these hormones are formed, and in part four, we'll put it all together with its regulation by the pituitary and the hypothalamus. So first, let's see what this organ looks like and where it comes from. This little H-shaped organ usually extends from the fifth cervical vertebra to the first thoracic vertebra. It has lobes. These two on the sides would be the lateral lobes, right and left. They're sort of conical and extend upwards towards the thyroid cartilage and down to about the fourth or fifth tracheal rings. The two are joined by a horizontal isthmus. And this gland sits in front of the trachea. Usually the isthmus sits over the second and third tracheal rings. So on a cross section, you'd see the trachea in front, the esophagus behind, and the thyroid gland would be hugging the trachea in front. Behind the thyroid gland are the parathyroid glands, usually embedded on the posterior surface of the lateral lobes. The parathyroid glands synthesize and secrete the parathyroid hormone, which is involved with calcium regulation. The thyroid gland produces the thyroid hormones, which have effects on a lot of organs in the body. But the thyroid gland also synthesizes and secretes a hormone that regulates calcium, that's calcitonin. So both the thyroid hormones and calcitonin come from the thyroid gland. This gland has a capsule. Actually has two capsules, a true and a false capsule. The true capsule is condensation of fibroelastic connective tissue of the gland. The false capsule is on the outside. It's formed from the cervical fascia. It's in front of the trachea, so it's the pre-tracheal layer of cervical fascia. If we go behind the thyroid gland, on its postural medial aspect, it's attached to the cricoid cartilage. This is by modified fascia called the suspensory ligament of Berry. Because of attachments such as this, the thyroid gland moves when one swallows. This is just one of the reasons. There are a few others, but that movement with deglutition is used to clinically assess swelling of the gland. The true capsule of the gland sends septa deep into the gland, and these septa have blood vessels and lymphatics. Because the thyroid gland is a very vascular gland. It's going to be producing the thyroid hormones, which have to enter systemic circulation. Those are by the thyroid follicles. It also produces calcitonin. That's formed by the parafollicular clear cells. All of these hormones need to enter circulation, and thus the thyroid gland is appropriately supplied with a lot of blood vessels, arteries, and veins. All arteries have to come from the heart. I'll first orient you to this schematic layout. Here we have the arch of the aorta with its three main branches. The left subclavian artery, the left common carotid artery, which will divide into external and internal carotid arteries. We just need the external for this. On the right, there's the brachiocephalic trunk. From that, the right subclavian artery and the right common carotid artery arise. Again, dividing into right external and internal carotid arteries. The thyrocervical trunk comes from the first part of the subclavian arteries. Now let's add in the thyroid arteries. It's mainly supplied by two arteries. Pretty easy to remember, the superior and inferior thyroid arteries. The superior thyroid arteries are the first branches of the external carotid arteries. They form anterior and posterior glandular branches, supplying the anterosuperior part of the gland. The anterior branch of each anastomoses with its partner from the opposite side. The inferior thyroid arteries come from the thyrocervical trunk. They are the largest branches of this trunk, which is from the first part of the subclavian artery. They supply the posterior-inferior aspect of the inferior poles of the gland. I've drawn the vessels that go behind the gland in broken lines. There's a lot of anastomosis between these superior and inferior arteries, making the gland very vascular. Sometimes, not always, there can be another artery called the thyroidea ima artery, which if present usually comes from the brachiocephalic trunk, but can also have variations in its origin, like it could come from the arch of the aorta itself. It's good to remember that anatomy can always have variations. Now this thyroidea ima artery is small and unpaired, unlike the other two. It reaches the isthmus of the thyroid and supplies the gland. That's three arteries. There are three veins as well, the superior, middle, and inferior thyroid veins, which drain the superior, middle, and inferior parts of the thyroid gland. The superior and middle thyroid veins drain into the internal jugular veins. The inferior thyroid veins drain into the brachiocephalic veins, right and left. Though the inferior veins could join together and just drain into the left brachiocephalic vein. The brachiocephalic veins join to form the superior vena cava, entering the right atrium, and we're back at the heart. So superior, middle, and inferior thyroid veins. Those are the main blood vessels, and when I make notes, I usually turn information like this into a map. So we have the superior and inferior thyroid arteries and the thyroidea ima artery. The superior one comes from the external carotid, the inferior from the thyrocervical trunk, and the thyroidea ima from the brachiocephalic trunk, usually. The veins are superior, middle, and inferior thyroid veins. The superior and middle drain into the internal jugular veins, while the inferior ones into the brachiocephalic veins. I'm going to add two things in here. Remember that the thyroid gland is sitting in front of the trachea near the larynx. There are nerves that primarily supply the larynx, accompanying these arteries of the thyroid gland, and that's really important during thyroid surgeries. The external branch of the superior laryngeal nerve accompanies the superior thyroid arteries, while the recurrent laryngeal nerves travel near the inferior thyroid arteries. Both these nerves are branches from the 10th cranial nerve, the vagus. The parasympathetic nerve supply of the thyroid gland also comes from the vagus. The sympathetic innervation is from cervical ganglia, the superior, middle, and inferior cervical ganglia. But these are not secretomotor fibers. They don't stimulate the release of a hormone or anything like that. They are vasomotor. They can change the diameter of blood vessels, causing constriction of these vessels. That's some stuff about blood vessels and nerves. And what about lymphatics? There are lymph nodes in front of the larynx, in front of the trachea, and on the sides of the trachea. That's prelaryngeal, pretracheal, and paratracheal lymph nodes. All these receive lymph from the thyroid gland. The prelaryngeal lymph nodes on top drain into the upper deep cervical lymph nodes, and the pre- and paratracheal lymph nodes into the lower deep cervical lymph nodes. The lateral lobes also drain directly into the deep cervical lymph nodes. So we've done blood vessels, nerves, and lymphatics. In addition to these two lateral lobes and the isthmus, the thyroid gland can have a pyramidal lobe. Usually, if present, it's on the left of the median plane and extends upwards. Why it's like that would make sense with a little embryology. Now, the best way to learn the embryology of the thyroid gland is actually with the pharyngeal arches and the development of the tongue. So I'll be talking about this more when I make that video. I'm just going to go over some of the essentials of its embryology. First, we'll see what needs to develop, and then we'll figure out how to get here. We have the thyroid gland in its pretracheal location in the neck, with its right and left lateral lobes, the isthmus, and the pyramidal lobe. It has a capsule around it and is supplied with nerves, blood vessels, and lymphatics. Thyroid follicular cells synthesize the thyroid hormones, and the parafollicular C cells synthesize calcitonin. Posteriorly, usually the four parathyroid glands are embedded. Now, where do all of these come from? The thyroid gland is a midline structure. It also develops in the midline, just not here. It starts higher up, near the tongue. Remember the three germ layers, the ectoderm, the mesoderm, and the endoderm. The thyroid gland develops from the endoderm. It starts off as an endodermal thickening in the floor of the primitive pharynx. Remember, it's near the developing tongue. It emerges between the anterior two-thirds and the posterior one-third of the developing tongue. This little outpouching is called the thyroid primordium. It's in the midline. This is the median primordium. And that median primordium is going to descend as the embryo grows. So it moves caudally, ventral, to the developing hyoid bone. It starts splitting at its end as it descends, and once it reaches its final pretracheal position, it becomes two lobes with an isthmus, though sometimes the isthmus can be absent. The squiggly line that I've drawn here is just to show that it descends. It does not zigzag like this as it descends. But this was the median primordium. There are also lateral primordia. But before I get to that, remember that there are four pharyngeal pouches. Ignore one and two. The third and fourth have dorsal and ventral parts. The dorsal part of the third forms the inferior parathyroid glands, while the dorsal fourth forms the superior parathyroid glands. They'll usually settle into their locations behind the thyroid gland as it descends. But the ventral fourth pharyngeal pouch forms the ultimobranchial or the ultimopharyngeal body. They form the lateral primordia. It actually comes from the cephalic neural crest cells which migrate into these pharyngeal pouches. So the ultimobranchial bodies or the ultimopharyngeal bodies form the lateral primordia and they fuse with the median primordium, contributing to the development of the parafollicular clear cells which will go on to synthesize calcitonin. Thus the C cells form from the ultimobranchial body, which forms from the ventral fourth pharyngeal pouch with migrated neural crest cells. Around the thyroid gland is neural crest mesenchyme, which is going to form the connective tissue capsule, and that'll invade the gland as septa with blood vessels, nerves, and lymphatics. Now, I mentioned that the thyroid gland descends to reach its final position, but it doesn't just move downwards, it stays connected to the tongue, for a while at least. That is by the thyroglossal duct. Thyro for obvious reasons and glossal for tongue. So it's a duct between the tongue and the thyroid gland. But this duct doesn't remain. It shouldn't remain. It degenerates and eventually disappears. The proximal opening of this duct near the tongue remains as a small pit. And this is after the duct is gone. This is called the foramen cecum between the anterior two-thirds and posterior one-third of the tongue. Down near the thyroid gland, the pyramidal lobe is actually an extension of the gland along the path of the duct. This is usually from the isthmus. It is thyroid tissue. It may be connected to the hyoid bone by a fibrous or fibromuscular band that's called the levator glandular thyroidea. It could connect the hyoid bone to the isthmus or to the pyramidal lobe. The thyroglossal duct should disintegrate, but sometimes it can remain in some locations, like just beneath the hyoid. That can form a swelling, and that's called a thyroglossal cyst. And since the thyroid gland has to travel to reach its final position, sometimes things can go wrong. It might be anywhere along that path. When it's not in its usual location, it's called an ectopic thyroid, like in the tongue when it's a lingual thyroid. Or it could be beneath the hyoid bone, anywhere along that path. This is different from the thyroglossal cyst. That was a duct remnant. This is functional thyroid tissue itself, which is just in a different location. But when the thyroid gland starts developing, the thyroid primordium is a mass of cells. It gets invaded by blood vessels separating the cells. Those cells then form a lumen such that they line that space. This is a thyroid follicle, and it's the functional unit of the thyroid gland. The gland has lots of these follicles, and this is where the thyroid hormones are going to form. And that's what we're going to look at in part two, the histological structure and function of the thyroid gland. But that was briefly about the anatomy and embryology of this gland. I hope this video was helpful. If it was, you can give it a like and subscribe to my channel. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.